X58 and the accompanying i7 CPUs were released all the way back in 2008. And then 2 years after that, there was an architecture known as Westmere, which was released in the form of the i7-980X, and also on the Xeon side, the X5650, and also one of my personal favorites, the X5675. Now these days, these 6-core, 12-threaded, overclockable Xeons can be had extremely cheap on AliExpress. Starting at around 10 bucks, you can get the X5650, and then if you're feeling a little bit more enthusiastic and passionate about X58, you can get the X5675, which is a better bin, at least from the testing I've done here, and that you'll get better overclocks for the same voltage versus the X5650. However, today I'm going to be using my Rampage 3 Extreme. Now this board is pretty special to me because I got given it to me for free in a deals hunt because the person who gave it away thought that it was broken because the water cooling kit on it had cracked and it had water that had leaked on the motherboard. And then since then I gave this board a bit of TYL, that is a tech yes loving for those of you who are new here, and I put two aftermarket heat sinks on there in a janky kind of way. And this board, it checks out. It takes my X5675 all the way to 4.5 gigahertz. And ultimately, that is what used price performance is all about. It's about getting those parts cheap and then making something out of it that can play games just as good as the new stuff can, except you're saving over half your money. However, here is the kicker. Today we're gonna be pairing this X58 motherboard, this CPU, with the overclocks and some DDR3 2133 megahertz in triple channel versus the 1680 V2 in quad channel versus the i9-10900K in dual channel with DDR4 Corsair Dominator and the Ryzen 9 3950X with an RTX 3090. This is the big grand behemoth of GPU gaming graphics cards right now, which if there's differences between these CPUs, it is definitely going to come out with this configuration. So let's get into a good old fashioned CPU comparison and see where our little Xeons lie in 2020. And that's like lie as in like placement, not lie as in telling a lie. But nowadays I kind of have to clarify my English because people get confused, but you won't get confused about this quick sponsor spot right here. Are you sick and tired of that Windows needs activation message in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen and you want to unlock some extra features in Windows 10? Well, if so, today's video sponsor, SCD Keys, has you covered. For as little as $14.50, you can instantly get that key and you can check out with PayPal. Make sure you use the coupon code TYC for an 18% discount. Let's get back to the video. Now, before we get into those gaming benchmarks, there's something that I like to do personally, and that is to disable Spectre and Meltdown updates. I've found that although there could be some risk, your computer could be more at a risk of being hacked, I've personally found that there hasn't been one documented case of someone, an individual, being hacked at their own home. And furthermore, the performance hit of Spectre and Meltdown takes around 10% performance away from Xeons like the X5675 and also the 1680 V2. Now I've included the 1680 V2, which is a third generation Ivy Bridge Xeon, for those of you who can't wait for an upcoming video where we're gonna be specifically talking about this Xeon. But with that aside, let's roll through the 1080p benchmarks first, where in Shadow of the Tomb Raider, our poor little friend here, the X5675, he did take a bit of a beating. Moving on to Doom Eternal showed a similar trend, but then moving over to Modern Warfare showed that the actual lack of AVX instruction sets, or more to the point, AVX2, showed that even the 1680 V2 was experiencing a little bit of a bottleneck here versus the Ryzen 9 and also the i9. Moving over to Mech Warrior 5 showed that our X5675 was falling behind a little bit too here. And then when it came to Fortnite, it was still putting up a respectable battle royale, if that was what we would call it, against the other CPUs. Tom Clancy's The Division 2, there was a pretty impressive result. And same with The Outer Worlds, it was doing its job. And then moving over to 1440p, it's actually more a similar trend to 1080p, where although the gap does minimize a bit, it is still there and it is still significant in a lot of these titles. And then lastly, when it comes to 4K, this is where things get pretty interesting, because in some of the titles you'll notice that there's no difference between this 10-year-old Xeon and the latest and greatest 10900K and Ryzen 9 3950X. Though this is where the question of what is the X5675 good for in 2020 comes about, because this CPU, if you want to go get it, which a lot of the times the X58 boards, you can pick them up very cheap on the used market. I'm finding that they're starting to become less popular as the years go on, and rightfully so. As time goes on, things get more obsolete, and of course, the parts get more at risk of failing, which those two things combined makes them a lot less desirable. However, even on places like eBay, you can pick up an X58 board nowadays for quite cheap, and coupled with a $10 CPU, you can get some really respectable performance. If you also couple it with, say, a Snowman $20 CPU cooler, you can be tasting 4.3, even 4.4 gigahertz on daily overclocks and getting some really good price performance for your dollar. Though the best part with X58, as we said before, is when we get them on these deals hunts where people think that the parts are so old that they must be worth absolutely nothing altogether. And of course, that X58 motherboard being the key element to getting the most out of this older platform. Whereas to me personally, when I found that I've overclocked on these older platforms, I've had a lot more success overclocking on the ASUS motherboards versus all the other brands back in this era. Though if you do want to check out how you can overclock one of these CPUs, then I'll put a tutorial right up here. Though one more thing to be aware of is that there are these boards out there that are being manufactured new on the X58 line, even in 2020. However, these boards pretty much don't have any support for overclocking. So that's one thing to be mindful of. If you want to get the most performance out of these older CPUs, then you'll definitely want to get a good motherboard. Though generally with X58, you'll want to stick to a ASUS motherboard, but if you can't find that, EVGA and Gigabyte do make some solid boards. However, with the Gigabyte models, I've found that sometimes they just have rare issues where the BIOS just doesn't work properly no matter what you do, and you're just scratching your head as to why overclocks don't work. If you're in that situation, don't worry. It's not just you. That Gigabyte motherboard has probably just seen too much use and it's acting a little bit finicky. Though in terms of MSI motherboards, you generally would have to go for the higher end boards, because I've tried a few of their entry-level X58 boards, and let's just say it hasn't ended well. They have either even failed on default clocks, or they just have really weird issues. Then the ASRock boards. You're probably thinking, what about the ASRock boards? I've actually had one of these boards come through, and although they are decent, I just find that they're so rare on the used market that they're not even really worth mentioning back in this era, because there wasn't that many of these boards manufactured to begin with. Then of course there are some other brands out there, most notably the Intel X58 boards, but they dropped support, even stopping the BIOS downloads completely for their X58 motherboards. So I would try and avoid them if you can. Anyhow, with that out of the way, we've seen the FPS differences between our beloved X58 and the latest and greatest stuff and somewhere in between. And that leads me at the question of, well, what graphics card should you be pairing with an X5675 Xeon? And well, I cross-referenced this with my RTX 3090 review, and we've got some pretty solid, I guess, consistencies running through these numbers, at least at 1080p. For instance, if we look at Tom Clancy's The Division 2, we can see that it lines up roughly around a 2080 Super. Then if we look at The Outer Worlds, we're sort of looking at around, again, a 2080 Super. Then moving on with Fortnite, we're at those levels of around a 2070 Super, then Modern Warfare 2080 Super, and then MechWarrior 5 2070 Super, and then Doom Eternal 2080 Super, and then lastly Shadow of the Tomb Raider Vega 64. So that pretty much averages out, in my opinion, with the best card if you're going to overclock an X5675, for example, the 4.5 gigahertz, and give it some decent memory. The best graphics card to match with that would be the RTX 2070 Super or a 1080 Ti, or of course you can get any card under that in terms of graphical performance, and you should be having happy days where you're not missing out on anything. Because in my opinion, when it comes to gaming on PCs, that's definitely the one thing you want to do, is get the most out of your GPU and make sure your CPU is in a bottleneck. So if you go out and buy a 2080 Ti, for example, and you're going to play at 1080p, then this CPU will be letting you miss out on a few FPS more than you otherwise should be able to obtain if you had a better CPU. Though on the flip side of things, the CPU and the motherboard combo can be had for a ridiculously good price. Just keep in mind that there are a couple of downsides to using this architecture. The first that we mentioned before is that there's not even AVX instruction sets, nor are there AVX2 instruction sets. AVX was introduced in Sandy Bridge era, that second generation, and then the AVX2 was introduced in fourth generation, that is Haswell and upwards. Then for the motherboards, they generally don't carry USB 3. There are some models that do carry USB 3, but they're a bit rarer than the ones that carry USB 2, which is pretty much all the X58 motherboards. Then for the SATA 3 ports, they're actually not true SATA 3. So think of it more of, hey, you're still gonna be ending up with SATA 2, though for most part, that's not gonna make a difference when it comes to playing PC games. And then of course, you're still stuck on PCIe Gen 2 X16, but I've done a recent test in this, and even an RTX 3090 can't completely saturate the PCIe Gen 2 bandwidth, believe it or not. I'll put the link to that video up here if you wish to look into it more. So all these negatives won't stop you, however, from playing games, unless it's Horizon Zero Dawn, which unfortunately wouldn't load due to it having no support for that AVX instruction set. So this is the one outlier where the games come out and the developers are just not even going to bother patching in support for the older CPUs. And so unfortunately we couldn't run the benchmarks for the X5675 with Horizon Zero Dawn. But that aside, that one game aside, and I think there's only one other game out there that does this as well, they are certainly not going to stop you in 2020 from getting one of these motherboards and a $10 CPU and having at least a 144Hz gaming experience. They can get up and boogie still in 2020 and they can give you an enjoyable, smooth gaming experience. Even if you couple it with the likes of an RTX 2070 Super or 2080 Super, you can have ultra settings, 144Hz gaming, and still have no issues. And that's all for today, folks. Do let us know in the comments section below what you think of X58 and also those budget Xeons in 2020. Do you share my same sentiments or do you think differently? Love reading your thoughts and opinions as always. And also, don't forget to toss us a like on the way out, because we got the question of the day here, which comes from Carter Damone, and they ask, would it be good for video editing in DaVinci 2? And they're referring to another Xeon, which we might be testing in the future as well after I do a build with it, and that is the E5-2678V3. This is a Haswell 12-core Xeon, 24 threads, that although locked, does give a lot of good value for money too, and doesn't really carry those limitations that the X58 carries, even in 2020. But to answer the question, yes, it will be very good for DaVinci, especially in terms of value for money, because you can couple it with DDR3 ECC registered memory, which is very inexpensive, and you'll have yourself a 64 gigabyte, 12 core, 24 thread, video editing workstation beast on a budget. And with all that aside, I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.